If you'd like to take a Bible and turn with me to 1 Kings chapters 5 to 7 this morning, and we'll read a little bit from the middle of that section, which is 1 Kings 6, starting at verse 37, which is on page 337. I've got to say, this is not the most riveting part of the Bible on first glance, as some of you may have discovered. So let me just give you a flavor of what's in here. Basically, Solomon plans to build the temple, then he builds the temple, then he furnishes the temple. So, however, this is God's word, and God promises to speak to us through it. 1 Kings 6 from verse 37. The foundation of the temple of the Lord was laid in the fourth year in the month of Ziv. In the 11th year in the month of Bul, the 8th month, the temple was finished in all its details according to its specifications. He had spent 7 years building it. It took Solomon 13 years, however, to complete the construction of his palace. He built the palace of the forest of Lebanon, 100 cubits long, 50 wide, and 30 high, with four rows of cedar columns supporting trimmed cedar beams. It was roofed with cedar above the beams that rested on the columns, 45 beams, 15 to a row. Its windows were placed high in sets of three, facing each other. All the doorways had rectangular frames. They were in the front part of the sets of three facing each other. He made a colonnade 50 cubits long and 30 wide. In front of it was a portico, and in front of that were pillars and an overhanging roof. He built the throne hall, the hall of justice, where he was to judge, and he covered it with cedar from floor to ceiling. And the palace in which he was to live, set farther back, was similar in design. Solomon also made a palace like this hall for Pharaoh's daughter, whom he had married. Let's pray together. We confess, Father, that when we read a part of the Bible like this, it doesn't set our hearts racing. But we believe that you know what you're doing when you give us these words, and we also trust you when you say that you will speak to us through every part of your word to strengthen us, to teach us about Jesus, and to help us to live for you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Since we were married almost 25 years ago, Fiona and I have moved house about 9 times. Now, at one level, I don't mind moving. You know, for me, the change of surroundings is often quite exciting. But compared to my wife, Fiona, my level of interest is minimal. Out of nowhere, color charts and swathes of fabric and possible bathroom layouts appear. And the atmosphere is charged with discussions of rugs that pick out the colors on the wall and the advantages of stone over ceramics and 1,000 other things that I have to say do nothing to fire my creative juices, which for me at least produces a certain sense of foreboding when it comes to 1 Kings 5 to 7. Because on the surface at least, these chapters are about building and interior decorating. Structurally, they read like the plans for a major home renovation followed by a scrapbook to give that new home something special. They elicit just about as much enthusiasm in me as an episode of The Block. This is one of those parts of the Bible that a friend of mine has described as inspiration that demands perspiration. And yet, despite having given these chapters such a massive build-up this morning, buried in the middle of these apparently uninspiring chapters are 4 ideas which, when you put them together, give one of the most concise and complete guides to living for God, to living for Jesus Christ, that I would say you'll find anywhere in the Bible. Need convinced? Well, come with me. Before we're deluged in a sea of carved pomegranates, cherubs, and other things, I want you to see what is driving these chapters. There's something very specific highlighted all the way through 1 Kings 5 to 7, which explains why Solomon and his vast army of willing and not so willing helpers do what they do. What is it? The writer's at pains to tell us that everything that happens in these chapters is driven by God's promise. There is power that motivates people to do stuff, motivates people for action in the promise of God. You can see that right at the start. If you have these chapters open in front, it really will help. 1 Kings 5, verse 3. Solomon has a discussion with a mate of his to the north, another king, King Hiram of Tyre, and says this, You know that because of the wars waged against my father David from all sides, he couldn't build a temple for the name of Yahweh as God until the Lord put his enemies under his feet. But now the Lord my God has given me rest on every side. There is no adversary or disaster. I intend therefore to build a temple for the name of the Lord my God, as the Lord told my father when he said, your son will do this job. Everything that happens in Solomon's international diplomacy is grounded in theology. Solomon says, I'm doing this because God has now fulfilled his promises. So even Hiram in verse 7 says, oh, your God's marvelous and blesses God. And it's a none too subtle reminder that what we're reading in these chapters is the promise of God being worked out. 5 verse 12, the Lord gave Solomon wisdom as he had promised him. Runs all the way through the section. Chapter 6, verse 1. In the 480th year after the Israelites came out of Egypt, in the fourth year of Solomon's, he began to build the temple. 480 years. Just as God promised, God brought them out of exile, brought them into a land. God's promise may often not be fulfilled at breakneck speed, but they will be fulfilled. And the emphasis on the time frame here, even in our reading, you picked up the number of times you get dates and months and days. Well, it tells us this is the biggest thing that has happened since the Exodus itself. After bringing his people out of Egypt, now finally they have moved in. They're settling down. The temple is in place. God has come through in his promises. So what now? Well, 6 verse 11. Makes it even clearer that what's happening in the Jerusalem construction industry has got everything to do with God's promise-based, covenantal dealings with his people. The word of the Lord came to Solomon, as for this temple you're building, if you follow my decrees and observe my laws and keep all my commands and obey them, I will fulfill through you the promise I gave to David your father, and I'll live among the Israelites and will not abandon them. I'll be your God. You'll be my people. This is classic covenant language. Even when when God tells Solomon to build this enormous bronze water dish called the sea, the big bowl is supposed to serve as a reminder that the Lord is the Lord of the chaotic sea, whether the Red Sea is a symbol of Egypt's power or simply of pre-creation hostility and disorder. This God's got it covered. You do get a lot of construction details in these chapters, but even the detailed information concerning the riveting installation of two freestanding pillars, complete with some very impressive lily work on top, reminds Israel that God is a promise-making God. 7 verse 21, Solomon puts up two pillars at the portico, kind of in the foyer of the temple. The pillar to the south he named Jachin, and the one in the north, Boaz. The capitals on top were in the shape of lilies, and so the work of the pillars was completed. Now, the names of those pillars mean strength, and he establishes. Now, if you read these pillars from right to left, and Hebrew's written right to left, so that's what everybody naturally did, they announce, in strength, God establishes. The pillars speak of the power and promises of God. They say, God is strong, we are weak, but he will bless us. They were a great reminder to insiders that God keeps his promises. And that's the ultimate motivation for sticking at serving Jesus. Okay? Now, the basic principle here in all these bewildering details is that we need hope to keep us going. You want to follow Jesus this week, you'll need hope. If you want to throw yourself into loving Jesus today and tomorrow and the next day, if you want to serve him for a lifetime, it's really important that you've grasped this simple concept, really. The power to live for Jesus comes from his promises. How does this work? I reckon I've got five basic reasons for getting out of bed in the morning and doing what I do. And they're all actually based on promises that God has made through Jesus. Here's the first. Christ will build his church. He said he will do it. That's going to happen, so it's a good thing for us to invest in. God will finish his work in us. That's what stops me waking up in the morning and just pulling the covers over my head and going back to sleep again. because God has said he'll finish what he has started in me. And sometimes the finish seems a lot further away than what God has done so far, but that's his promise. God will judge the world in Jesus Christ. Ultimately, when bad stuff happens, when evil people get away with things, when injustice unfolds right in front of my nose, I can wait because God said he will judge the world in Christ. God will recreate the universe, reconciling all things to him in Christ. He will recreate a new universe that's a better version of this one. And I can keep going because one day we will see God as he is and enjoy him forever if we belong to the people of the Lord Jesus. See, if you don't get any of that, if none of that moves you or influences you or shapes you, then you will lack motivation, urgency, stickability, oomph, whatever you want to call it, in your Christian life. You see, gratitude's really important and works as a motivator for a while, but it wears off. Ultimately, people like us need to be moved by hope, by what's in front of us. We need to realize that there is actually power in the fact that God keeps his promises and will keep them. That's the first thing I want you to notice in all this. And the second, well, it's delight in the detail. One of the things I love about being in Australia is that it's normal to be interested in cricket. You know, to know Don Bradman's batting average is no longer the mark of a sports nerd, but of a well-adjusted member of the human race who is a very happy adopted Australian. You know, to notice that the ball started to reverse swing or that Steve Smith has got a worsening habit of walking away to the leg side, that is not weird. That's kind of acceptable and even admirable here. Now, I think I would have got on well with the writer of these chapters because this guy has an eye for detail. Well, when he's describing the labor force which built the temple, what do we get? Detail. 1 Kings 5:13. Solomon conscripted laborers from all Israel, 30,000 men. He sent them off to Lebanon in shifts of 10,000 a month so that they spent 1 month in Lebanon and 2 months at home. There's a guy called Adoniram in charge of the forced labor. Solomon had 70,000 carriers and 80,000 stone cutters in the hills, as well as 3,300 foremen who supervised the project and directed the workers. Now, I would not have written it like this, right? But that's why the PCQ has not employed me as a project manager in the new building. I'd be going, we've got a new building, it looks great, that'll do, you know. But this writer wants us to see something else. Detail, detail. He tells us where the workers came from who cut the stone. When he's talking about the doors of the temple, for goodness sake, what do we get? 1633. He made the door frames out of olive wood that were 1/4 of the width of the hall. He also made two doors out of juniper wood, each having two leaves that turned in sockets. Now, if that floats your boat, that's fantastic. I'm reading that thinking, I don't even know what those words mean. No. 6:36. He built the inner courtyard of 3 courses of dressed stone and 1 course of trimmed cedar beams. It's probably an earthquake protector. The same thing when he's talking about the sea, this big bowl, 7:23. He made a sea of cast metal, circular in shape, 10 cubits from rim to rim. It took a line of 30 cubits to measure around it. Below the rim, girds encircled it, 10 to a cubit. The girds were cast in 2 rows in one piece with the sea. Now, you know, I'm not all that interested that there were girds on it, but he's only getting started. How many girds, how they were arranged, and so it goes on. Detail, detail, detail. Now, why is he doing all this? There are 2 reasons. The first is theological. The attention paid to carvings and replicas of flowers and gourds and lilies and palm trees and pomegranates and all kinds of leaves is not accidental. The importance of using cedar and cypress everywhere is not accidental. All this is painting a picture of the Garden of Eden. The garden, now the temple, is where God has made it possible for people like us to meet with him. Now, the temple is going to be a pale imitation of Eden, but that's what it is. It's a new opportunity to meet with God. That's why you got all this detail. The second reason is, well, doxological is the only word I can think of, is to promote us, to make us say, wow, that's fantastic. It's done like this because of the sheer overwhelming beauty of God, because God is worth it. How do we know that? There's something you need to know about this building. Nobody would ever walk in a significant part of it. The gold leaf on the walls wasn't there to stop little fingers from getting splinters, because there would be no little splinters in that part of the temple ever. All this work goes into a space that no human being would ever walk in. So what's the point? It's because our God is so magnificent. We're given an audio tour because we're those who'll never get into the temple. We'll not get past the porch. But we're saying, you know, in there, this building is so beautiful because our God is so beautiful. Now, I don't know about you, I think this sounds weird to us today. We inhabit a world of comfortable seats and mixing desks and high-quality speakers. Our aesthetic concerns stretch to the quality of the graphics on the screen and the font and the bulletin, but not much further. Now, we're rightly concerned about comfort and how church looks to the outsider. And it's a real challenge for us today to routinely match the feel, the quality of what goes on in church with what is just normal outside church now. That's important, but it's not what's going on here. The temple is not seeker-sensitive. Nobody's going to get in here, let alone outsiders. All this stuff, all this beauty, this art is just for God's sake. The craftsmen are doing this, aren't doing it for public acclaim. Because nobody's going to walk around and say, oh, no, Hiram did that. They're not going to see it. They're doing it to honor and please God. There's dignity and satisfaction and fulfillment in doing work that no one would see just because they were doing it for God. I think that's challenging. I wonder if we've lost sight of the idea of doing stuff purely and simply for God. I wonder if we've misplaced the idea of just of devotion, of finding joy in living for God and with God in all the details of life. See, the air we breathe today is highly pragmatic. What's valued is what is effective. Doing is prioritized over being and certainly over enjoying. I don't think it's pushing it to say that appearance and impact are what matter to us. And what the Bible does here is it takes us inside this emerging temple and makes us sit down and watch as some unknown guys carve some pretty patterns that nobody else will ever see. So that we get the fact that there really is delight in the detail. A man called Charles Simeon, whose preaching many years ago revolutionized the city of Cambridge and actually started off a movement that we're still part of today, as he put expository preaching back in the hands of the church, once said this. He said, there are two lessons for every Christian to learn. The one is to enjoy God in everything. The other, to enjoy everything in God. There are some things we do simply to bring pleasure to God, and in that we find pleasure. Not everything has to have a function, because all things, all truth, all knowledge, all order, all beauty ultimately are a reflection of the beauty of God himself. We need to be able to delight in the detail. And as this is clearly alliteration day, you do also need to notice the contrast in the construction. Right in the middle of the painstaking description of the blocks and bits and pieces in the temple comes chapter 7. Now, in the Bible, interruptions are always important. You know, when you read something, you think, did I miss something there? Was there a bit taken out in between? They're always given to grab our attention. Well, 6 verse 2, we get the riveting bit that I read. Well, we find out that Solomon's temple, 6 verse 2, measured 60 cubits by 20 by 30. That's about 30 meters by 10 by 15. It's not very big, is it? Just think about it. You could comfortably fit that in here. Yeah, Solomon's temple, 30 by 10 by 15. And then 6 verse 37, where I started to read, well, we actually find that he built his own house, verse 2 of chapter 7, 100 cubits long, 50 wide, and 30 high. Now, I don't want to be too hard on Solomon here, but do the maths, okay? His house was almost twice as big as the temple. Took him almost twice as long to build. And whilst there's no missing the fact that the narrator is much less interested in Solomon's house than in Yahweh's house, it's the same word in Hebrew, it's clear where Solomon's heart priorities lie. Yep, he built a house for Yahweh. But he also built a house for himself, twice as big, just next door. Now that sent a pretty clear message in the ancient world. Just in case you think I'm reading too much into the significance of the floor plan, the narrator adds in that little comment right at the end of the part I read. Oh, and by the way, he also built a house for Pharaoh's daughter. Solomon did a great job with the temple. And he kind of blew it by building his own house twice the size next door. Oh, and a house for Pharaoh's daughter on the same street as the house for Yahweh, the God of Israel. Now, I'd never want to say that King Solomon shouldn't have built a palace. And if you're building a palace, by definition, I suppose it has to be spacious. But the house that he builds says a lot about him. Tends to be that way, doesn't it? Whether we like it or not, where we choose to live, you know, car we choose to drive, the way we spend our money, it's usually a pretty good barometer of where our heart is. For many years ago, there's a kind of daytime show in the UK called Through the Keyhole. I'm not sure if it made it to Australia. Two teams would try to identify a minor celebrity who had allowed the host to go poking around in their house. And I just wonder, if we were to have our own version of, you know, Through the Keyhole right now, and I told you that, you know, I'd got Jayesh lined up with a video camera in your house and we're about to stream it to the screen, apart from the panic that that would bring to many of us, thinking it's a complete mess this morning. But honestly, how would you react as you saw it played out in front of you? If you were to see your room, your house, your bank account, there were a little video of the kind of the last week of the life of your family. Sure, it would show up stuff that none of us would be proud of. But what would the big message be? How would we feel? Does the way we live say sacrifice and simple living and service, or does it say self-indulgent? Does it say it's all about Jesus or it's all about me? Sadly, in Solomon's case, all he had to do was walk down the main street of Jerusalem to answer that question. Oh, it's a beautiful temple. Wow, that's a big house. So there's power in the promise. There's delight in the detail. There's contrast in the construction. Just wait for it. There's dependence on the David-eyed. I'm sorry. It is a proper word, believe me, but I was, you know, it's the only word I could think of beginning with D. Depend on the one who comes from David's family. Now, the key passage in this whole section is really telling. I mentioned it a minute ago. It's 6:11 to 13. As for this temple you're building, if you stay on track, I'll live among the Israelites and won't abandon my people. Now, what's remarkable about that is it actually downplays the significance of the temple. It's as if God says, now, about the temple. Don't worry about the temple. It's not the main issue. You are. No pressure, Solomon, but it's really about you. The future of his people, including the future of the temple, hinges on one man and on the obedience of one man. He says, Solomon, if you walk in my statutes, obey my rules, keep all my commands, if you manage to keep the covenant, all will be well. Everything will be fantastic. And I'll establish my word among your people. That's quite a lot of pressure. If Israel is to flourish, this is what it's going to take. It's all going to depend on the David-eyed, the one from David's family. It's all going to depend on Solomon. Now, if you've been with us over the past few weeks, you should be feeling decidedly nervous at this point. Because Solomon's great, like the rest of us. He has some fantastic moments, but dependable isn't the word I picked to describe him. He built a great temple. He made some great choices. He wrote some great books. He prayed some great prayers, as we'll see next week. But he also made some terrible choices. He built a very, very great temple to himself and another one for his pagan wife. if everything depends on the Son of David, which God says it does, then the future doesn't look all that bright after all. Now, I don't want to spoil the rest of the book of 1 Kings for you, but you do need to know that the Son of David won't pull this off. Solomon won't manage to keep the covenant, walking in all the laws and statutes and commands of God. I don't want to spoil the rest of the Old Testament for you, but you do need to know that God's word will not be established in his people for very long, and that one day the voice of God will go decidedly quiet. Until one day God speaks to Joseph, son of David, about his descent. And suddenly everything changes. In his gospel, Matthew describes a controversy when Jesus and his disciples decide to pick and eat some grain when they're walking through a field in the Sabbath. An argument starts about whether or not Jesus is greater than David. They encounter a demon-possessed man a few verses later, and the crowd says, "Could this be the son of David?" And a few lines after that, Jesus makes an announcement. He says, "One greater than Solomon is here." When Jesus shows up, he says, "I am the fulfillment of God's ultimate promise. I am the one in whom all the promises of God converge and then explode in unanticipated glory." When we read of Jesus, he is the one who truly delights in the Father and makes it possible for us to share in that delight. He is one who doesn't just build a temple, but says, "I am the temple of God. It's in me that you meet God." When Jesus comes, he doesn't just keep the covenant, he sets up the new covenant through his death. So is your life short on power, lacking delight? You're wasting time building with the wrong materials in the wrong place for the wrong reason. Do you desperately need someone to come and bail you out by doing things properly, to do for you what you can't do for yourself? Then look no further, because one greater than Solomon is here. His name is Jesus Christ, the one in whom all the promises of God find their fulfillment, the one who brings glory to God in every detail of his life and in his death for us, who is the temple. So why are these chapters here? Why all this building manifest, all this decorative detail? It's simple. It's to encourage us to gaze on the beauty of our God and King, as he's revealed here in 1 Kings, but more than that, as he is revealed ultimately in the Lord Jesus Christ, who says, "One greater than Solomon is here." Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the richness of the Bible. Thank you that it's unexpected and gets under our skin and makes us think. But we thank you most of all that ultimately it is all about Jesus. And that all this promise keeping and all these details and all these dodgy decisions ultimately drive us to the place where we see that it's only Jesus Christ, the one who's fulfilled all your promises and who makes us promises. We pray that today you'd help us to fix our eyes on Jesus again, and to live this week knowing that he is the one who will build his church, who will finish his work in us, who will restore this whole universe, and who will make it possible for people like us to know and enjoy you forever. For we pray all this in his name. Amen.